All right, folks, and we're back again. I'm Casey Green. I'm with Campus Computing. We're here in San Diego at the ASU GSV Innovation Conference. I'm pleased to welcome Jacob, or Yaki Dayan, who is chairman and CEO of EdTech Israel. Yaki, thanks for joining us today.
Well, Mike, thank
you for
inviting
me. You've come a long way to be at this conference, an innovation conference.
Yes, it seems like the best place to be in if you're in educational technologies, yes.
So I want to talk about this notion of Israel as startup nation. Many people have heard about the book. They've perhaps heard that a little bit in terms of about all out of the ed tech. Some people may know that, in fact, or their direct experience with that is that Waze was purchased by Google. That actually came out of an Israeli startup. Let's talk a little bit about the culture of ed tech and the startup nation. Your background is, in fact, you were an engineer. Your background is also in telecommunications. You are now trying to bring that into ed tech in Israel. But again, let's start with the startup nation concept and how that happens.
Well, I think that Israel has the reputation of being a startup nation for many reasons. One of the reasons is that we have a lot of innovation in Israel. People, when, you know, students, when they finish high school, they go to the army, and over there they have the opportunity to sometimes to work with the latest technologies and latest materials that are available. We highly emphasize innovation and creativity, and this is part of the Israeli spirit. We have a very good, I would say, background or track record of doing a lot of innovative companies in the past. Including today, we are second to California in IPOs. And many of the international names like the Intels, Apples, Google, so forth, they have their R&D centers in Israel. So all this cultivates an entrepreneurial spirit that is actually, all over. I mean, it's one of the...
I know that when I was in Israel 2 years ago, there are these tech corridors, you know, looks very much like Silicon Valley or being in Boston in terms of large buildings and corporate parks and very big international tech logos on those buildings, and also a lot of startups as well.
And if you come to Israel these days, you see that also there's been a lot of small boutique places where they started, you know, where they feel not so much comfortable with the big places. So they created smaller places to foster innovation and creativity. And over there, it's a very different atmosphere than the corporate mentality that we are familiar with.
Great. I'm going to do a moment of housekeeping. I want to remind our audience that we are potentially interactive. You can post questions, and potentially we can even bring you in live to ask a question of Yaki if you'd like to do so. So let's then move from the broad conversation about startup nation and technology in Israel to EdTech in Israel. When we were talking earlier, you mentioned that in some ways there's some challenges about EdTech in Israel that you don't see in the U.S. and you don't see in China and not in some other areas.
Yeah, I think that's the one of the main challenges for educational technologies in Israel is for an Israeli startup to succeed, it needs to go international. Mm-hmm. They don't go through the local market. The local market is too small for them, only about 1.8 million students, 130,000 teachers, mostly in Hebrew. That's not a market that you go for. Israel could be a very good beta site, but you always go to the international markets.
Right.
And, you know, one of the things that I found out in educational technologies is that today they don't compete very well with other sectors like cyber and IoT. So today...
You're talking about cybersecurity and consumer products as well?
Of course. I mean, we know Waze, we know Mobileye, we know Fiverr, all those names, we know Kaltura, Wix. We know a lot of Israeli names that are in different sectors, but when it comes to educational technologies, things are acting different. And they act different because a nation, if you look at things at a national level, we have other things to offer to the world, mm-hmm. and it's not necessarily the right thing, the same thing that you would experience, let's say, here in the U.S. from EdTech companies. I think that EdTech, as a global phenomenon, is actually creating a challenge, and this challenge is manifested in a different way in every different country. So for Israel, the EdTech challenge is different than it is for China and different from what you see over here in the U.S.
Mm-hmm. And what are the areas that you particularly are focusing on in terms of your own activities?
Well, I think that you mean about EdTech Israel.
Yeah.
Well, EdTech Israel started a year and a half in the notion that we can make a difference on the Israeli EdTech sector. And we, you know, we believe in the butterfly effect. We want to be the butterfly that creates a change in such a complex system. And the way that we want to do it is by allowing Israeli companies to reach out to the world and do it not only on an individual basis, but on a national basis. We see that there is a lot of strength when you aggregate all those companies together and you invite the world to see what's happening over there, what is available, what are the technologies. There are about 1,000 people doing mostly R&D in EdTech in Israel. This is something that the world does not know about, and this is something that we are trying to change. And that's most of the activities that we do.
A lot of that, the Startup Nation you mentioned, comes out of the experience of people working together through their required military service.
Yeah.
That would seem to foster an earlier experience with collaboration than students might have in university, of being on their own. But these teams form earlier. There's a culture that fosters collaboration. And we know collaboration is very important in a technology and entrepreneurial culture.
I think that that's part of the thing that we try to do is actually to create a community around that. If you looked at the Israeli EdTech sector like a year and a half ago, there was not it was not declared as a community. It was not declared as a sector that needs attention by itself. Today, a year and a half after, we see a lot of signs that it's changing. We see a lot of signs also from, let's say, a government perspective. We are going to have a very interesting summit in Israel in June. And for the first time, we received a sponsorship from the Ministry of Economy and Industry in Israel because they understand that this is a sector that needs to be addressed by the government itself.
Mm-hmm. How much government role is there? In different countries, there are protected industries. In different countries, there are industries that get special support. How does that play out in terms of EdTech in Israel?
Right now, we are pretty much off the radar for the government in this area. There's a lot of discussion about changing schools and making reforms in schools, and all these discussions always exist, and those discussions generate a lot of attraction. However, there's still this balance between philanthropy and business, between ROI and impact and social ROI.
Yeah.
And this balance is not so easy for some people to understand. Some people regard education as fully philanthropic franchise. This is something that we are trying to change the mindsets of VCs, of angel investors in Israel, that EdTech can be also a business sector with ROI and social ROI that are inseparable, but they do well to humanity. And this is something that we, I think this is right now in the center of discussion in Israel about where is the investment coming from? Should the investment come from philanthropy?
Yeah.
Or should the investment come from VCs? But those VCs, should they spend it?
All right.
Yeah, okay.
This is our Bill Clinton moment. Those of you may remember the 1982 election when a light fell on Bill and Hillary Clinton during a critical interview. I'm going to push this to the side a little bit, we'll be okay. It's our nighttime interview, okay?
Nighttime interview.
We're in the bar now as opposed to the middle of the afternoon.
Okay, so if you go back to the discussion about a social impact investment, this is something that is generating a lot of interest these days in Israel, but it's not still clear how it's actually going to materialize.
I want to come back to the fact Israel is a small country. There's issues about culture and values and history. How much do you think that that's very sort of embedded in this notion of startup nation that makes it, that provides a competitive advantage?
I think that partly it is to the fact that we always know that we need to look internationally. Mm-hmm. I think that's maybe the essence of that. We know that Israel is always like, could be a very good beta site, could be a very good testing ground, but we always think global. I think that because of the track record of companies like ICQ and Waze and so many others, for Israeli entrepreneurs, they look at the global markets as something that they reach for, and they have enough role models so they can associate themselves with. And I think that very interesting thing that I see today in education technologies is that many of the entrepreneurs are people that already have done something in their lifetime. Maybe they've done one exit or two. They are coming to education with more patience, mm-hmm. with more, I would say, values other than look at just the business models. And this creates a very interesting, characteristics to this new sector that is not necessarily behaving like the other sectors that we see today on the Israeli high-tech market.
Okay. And in terms, again, this export market, we were talking earlier, you talked about China, U.S., Europe. Are there some that are more interesting than others, some that are more challenging, some that are paying special attention to startup EdTech Israel than others?
Well, I think that this is fascinating because when you, I've been to Beijing in December, and what I found over there is a totally different a vibe than you feel here in the U.S. Like 3 years ago, the Chinese EdTech market did not exist, and then they started to pay attention to EdTech, and maybe you know, some, by some of the numbers, they claim that they are even greater in terms of investments than what's happening in the U.S. right now.
Yeah.
And they came to Israel and they found a lot of interesting companies, and they are coming again in June with a delegation of 32 people, a business delegation, because what they found over there are things that they believe are innovative and unique, and they've not seen in other places. And I think that this is part of the dialogue that we can be done on a nation basis.
Mm-hmm.
Israel has something to offer, and what Israel has to offer is different what China has to offer in this specific sector, and what the U.S. has to offer, maybe even what the U.K. has to offer.
Great. Yaki, thank you very much for joining us for the conversation today. Again, this is Yaki Dayan, who is chairman and CEO of EdTech Israel.
And thank you very much.
We're going to take a short break. We're going to put the light back on, get a little work a little bit on that. Next up, joining me is Michael King, who's the Vice President and General Manager of IBM's Global Education Industry. We'll be right back. Yaki, thanks.
Thanks a lot.